Good morning, Professor Clausen. This is Brandon Colburn, and this is my quality of character presentation for MCAA 530, Sports and Ethics. As you know, I've chosen adaptable as my quality of character, and I think it's very important to be adaptable as a coach, as a leader. Those who don't change end up losing relevance somewhere over time. If you don't have the tools in your kit to adapt to the world you live in, you're not going to be successful for very long, if at all. On this first page, the first thing I could think of for adaptable that was really apparent to me was a Swiss Army knife. So I thought, hey, I'd do a Swiss Army knife. And as I was looking through the Google images, I saw the largest Swiss Army knife created by the company, and that's called the Wegener Giant. It's got about 140 some odd different functions, about 89, 90 something different implements. And it's really, after I start thinking about it, not a good idea because it's so big and cumbersome, it's not exactly that useful. But it does give an image of the various types of tools you might need to pull out as a coach or a leader to continue to be relevant in your message as you teach it to people, as you teach it to new people that come in. I've been coaching now for over 20 years. The messages that I preach today, the morals and the ethics are the same. The way I give those messages and how I get those messages out there are very, very different. Some things are the same because they continue to work, but there's certain things that just fall flat. I've coached at two different high schools. I've coached from Pop Warner level all the way to high school. A message that might get through to a 7-year-old coaching Pop Warner is not gonna get through to a 18-year-old senior in high school. Things that worked at another high school that I worked at are very different than the things that get through to kids at Fontana High School where I currently work at. So being adaptable, I think, is one of the more important things that's got me to the point where I'm at as a coach, any successes I've had. And many failures that I've had were because it took me a long time to realize I needed to adapt to a new situation. George Santayana, I have to be very careful when I say that. It was so much easier when I thought it was Winston Churchill. But George Santayana has a very famous quote. Background, I'm a history teacher, so a lot of things I do are based on the lessons of history. He has this quote that those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. You've heard this in various iterations, I'm sure. He said this in 1905. I'm sure he probably didn't invent it. It was probably said long before him. Many of us smart people steal the great words of those who've come before us. If we can remember who they were, we give them credit. If not, hey, sometimes we take credit. But this one I'm not going to take credit for, Mr. Santayana. And the other quote right next to it is not really a quote. It's a definition I was given. I'm sure it might have been given to me sometime younger, but it really sticks in me. A professor I had going to college in a history class stated that history is the study of change over time. And the lesson of that was that no matter what you do in life, no matter how things work, the only thing constant, the only thing that's going to happen the same every day is things are going to change. Sun's going to come up, sun's going to go down. People are going to live, people are going to die. New people are going to rise. It's going to happen. The cycle is going to continue to happen. It's going to happen over and over again. And nothing ever stays the same. And even if we live in Southern California where we think it's 90 degrees every day, hey, guess what this year? Torrential downpours. Go figure. So things will always change. It's the only constant in history. I'm going to peek back and forth because you could tell where my laptop is that has my slides. So I'm sorry. I haven't been in front of a classroom in about 5 years, so I lost my touch a little bit. However, according to Merriam-Webster, the term adapt has various definitions. They all mean about the same thing. I popped a few of them up here. The first is to make fit, often by modification. The second is to change behavior so that it is easier to function in a particular place or situation, or to make or become suitable or able to function. This is what adapting means. I spoke in an email to Professor Clausen when I was when I chose this, and I said it could be a very slippery slope to make adaptable a quality of character when we're talking about ethics. But in this case, and I'll get to it later too, this is not about adapting your ethics. It's not about adapting your values. It's about adapting how you share those values based on when you're sharing them and who you're sharing them to. You know, one of the things I talk to kids about a lot of times is time and place. what things are appropriate in certain times and certain places. You know, if I'm talking to my players, it might be different than when I'm talking to their parents about certain things. Parents have more shared life experiences with me, and I can talk things differently, where if I talk to players, I might have to explain myself a little bit more, and vice versa. Parents may not understand the shorthand that goes on the field as we coach, where the kids get it because they've seen it every day. They've done the practice. I name a certain drill, kids go do it, and the parent goes, oh my God, that sounds, oh, no, relax, the kids know what it is. It's, you know, we just had to give it a nice catchy name so the kids would remember what it was, wouldn't have to explain it every day. So on and so forth. But let's move on. I've got several slides, several synonyms on this slide for the term accommodate. You know, we have to accommodate who we're speaking with. When I'm talking to my coaches as an athletic director, I have to carry a certain message to them. And I have to accommodate my bosses from above. Hey, I'm just the athletic director. I'm in control of the entire athletic program. That's fantastic. But I have a principal who's my boss. And she has a superintendent who's her boss. And there's a district athletic director who's also partially my boss. And so I have to accommodate the people around me and the message in the messages that I'm giving out. Yes, I want to stand for what I do. I want to stand for the values that I'm trying to preach, but I have to work within the confines of what they're giving me and what they allow me to have. Acclimate. You know, you can't just start with a message. I'm a baseball coach. I just happened to be talking to a friend who has an 8-year-old who wants to get into pitching. Great, awesome. Can I work with their kid? Well, yes, I can. I'm not a pitching coach. I'm a baseball coach. My knowledge of baseball pitching a baseball is very basic because I'm a catcher. I didn't worry about pitching. So this 8-year-old might actually be better working with me than working with a private pitching coach who might have a more high level. I can acclimate the kid to the world. I can start building up the right processes and the foundation, and then move on to somebody else. You know, adapting to what needs to be done. You know, adjusting, like I said before, how you say the message, who you give the message to. Conforming to, like I said, my boss. You know, my boss has things that she thinks are very important, and they are important in the span of education, and they might take more work from our behalf as athletes, as coaches and athletic directors, but hey, she's right. There's things we have to do to help further the academic mission of our school, which is why the school exists. So on and so forth. And you see the other synonyms that are there. I can go over each one, but you'll hear the words pop up as we go through. I don't want to bore you with too many descriptions of words you already know. Whoops. Scanned a little too far from me. You didn't see that, but I did. 1 Corinthians. Paul gives a message, and I'm not going to read it to you. You'll see it on the slide there. But it gives a message that I thought was appropriate to the point I was trying to make. When speaking with the Jews, I became as a Jew. When speaking to those under the law, I became as those under the law. Speaking to those outside the law, I became as those outside the law. When I'm speaking to the athletes at Fontana High School, I have to become one of the athletes at Fontana High School. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm going to become a 15-year-old sophomore football player. What it means is I have to understand the world they're living in and the world they're coming from. I have an advantage. I did go to Fontana High School. Shockingly, I work at the school I grew up at. Hey, I work at the school my father went to. But it's a very different Fontana High School in 2017 than it was in 1992 when I graduated, or 1967 when my father graduated. Fontana, the town itself, has gone from a small steel mill town where everybody in town either worked for the mill or tied to somebody that worked for the mill. And most people, when they graduated high school, was going to end up working in that mill. Today, the mill is gone, replaced by a much more famous racetrack. And when you talk to kids about the steel mill and you show them pictures, they actually find it puzzling that you could put a steel mill where there's a racetrack now. Where did it fit? They think the racetrack was there all the time. It's a different message. The demographic has changed from what was blue collar. It was still a very diverse town, but there was still a predominantly working collar or blue collar working class white town to now a very heavily Hispanic. Our high school itself is over 85% Hispanic. And going from working class and people who were, lower middle of the working class era, but they had good jobs, good union jobs, to now the vast majority of our kids are in Title I funding, meaning that they're under, the poverty line or right at the poverty line. So the messages we have to put out there and the things that we have to emphasize have to be different from what was emphasized to me. I have to put myself in the shoes of these kids when I tell them the things I want them to value. I have to put it in their world. And I think that's what Paul is talking about here when he's trying to share the message, a great message, but if I don't put myself in the shoes of the Jews, are the Jews going to accept my message? If I don't put myself in the shoes of the people who live by the law, are they going to share my, or they're going to understand my message? So to me, this means you have to adapt your delivery of the message based on who you're delivering it to. My working definition of adaptable for this is very simple. It's the ability to change what you do and how you do it in order to make it suitable for to function in a particular place or environment. Okay. I say it all the time, and people might think it's unethical, but there's a different vocabulary between players and coaches than there is between players and parents. There's a different vocabulary you'll use on your practice field where you're safe, where you're with everybody who shares the same goal and is on the same message. You wouldn't take that vocabulary and put it somewhere else. One of our school quotes is bleed maroon. It's our school color. It's something we believe in. It's something that goes back a long way. But when we share our bleed maroon, we want to put it up as a mural on our school. And unfortunately, the superintendent didn't think very highly of it. And we thought, what? This is something Fontana has always said, bleed maroon. She says, yes, and we have no problem with you saying that. But when you put it on the wall, all that the superintendent was thinking was, gee, I hope nobody's really bleeding out here and somebody gets a video with that in the background. And it made a lot of sense in our world where there's such sensationalized violence on the news and things like that. Yeah, we changed our mural. We made it once a stealer, always a stealer. Another equally old phrase that we've always used, but just had to adapt what we're putting because of the audience, the environment we're putting it in. By the way, we still bleed maroon. Okay, a couple quotes from some very smart people over time have looked at things. George Bernard Shaw says, those who cannot change their minds cannot change anything. And this is true. If you can't change your mind, if you can't look at something differently than the way it's been taught to you or the way you've ever seen it, then you're not going to ever change anything. You're just going to keep on this straight path. And that's great if your world allows you to stay on this great path, on the same path, and everything works and everything functions. In the world of coaching, we're going to realize somewhere along the line that we've got to make a change. You may not have the same athletes, you may not have the same people. School I work at has 2,600 kids today, which is fine. Four grades, 2,600 kids. We have some talented kids, but we also share a town with four other high schools. When I graduated, there was only one high school in our town. That was in 1993. So we're talking 20 plus years. We've grown that much as a school. So what does that tell you? That tells you that the level of depth is not going to be there. You have to change what you do. Hey, in the 1980s, 90s, you have these hard, slavish practices, kids beating themselves up, going full speed. Hey, somebody gets hurt, that's okay. We've got three guys that can fill the bill. Well, nowadays we don't have that depth. So we have to change what we do to fit that. We can't have abusive practices, which A, it's already wrong, and we know this, but you can't put kids through these ringers that they may be injured, they may come out of, because A, it's wrong, morally and ethically, but B, you don't have anybody behind them to take that place when you hurt that kid out of your bad practices. If you want to talk about genius ideas, hey, why not bring up Albert Einstein, right? The measure of intelligence is your ability to change, and I really think there are people who are very smart and they can read a book and they can tell you everything that's in that book. But if they can't adapt the world around them as things go on, they don't come off as very bright. And unfortunately, their success is not very well either. In this case, obviously, Einstein thought very highly of people who can change. Now, if you can change and you can make things work and you can change the way you look at things, hey, that's going to make you much more intelligent than the next guy. And of course, another thing we've seen by James P. Lewis here, if you always do what you've always done, you always get what you always got. And that's great. There's a little bit of a myth to this because sometimes you can always do what you always done and not get what you got before. That goes back to, you know, the things around you have changed. And if you don't recognize that change, you're gonna keep sharing the same message like you've always done it, and it's going to get less and less effective. In this case, you have to look at it and go, hey, am I still getting that positive result? Is it still happening? No, I better change something if I'm getting a negative result now. When I was 5 years old, my dad handed me this board. It was like a plastic little board, a little fiberglass board. And on it was this funky little pyramid made of blocks with writing in them. And, gee, Dad, what's this? My dad goes, don't worry about it. Read it. Look at it. You'll figure it out. Yep, I was kind of a child prodigy. I was a pretty good reader at age 5. And what it was John Wooden's Pyramid of Success. And since that time, I've become kind of a devotee of John Wooden. I've read several of his books, believe a lot in him, and I get very angry. People suggest he might have had help recruiting those kids from an unethical booster in these days. But hey, either way, John still has some great things to say. What you have here is a quote from one of his books where he talks about Wilt Chamberlain changing him. Not changing Wilt Chamberlain, mind you, a much younger person than Coach Wooden, hadn't had the same success as a coach and a leader. He went and saw a press conference by Wilt Chamberlain, and something that Wilt Chamberlain said there changed John Wooden. To me, I wasn't floored by this because I know how intelligent the man is and what he went through. It's odd because I know the people that have gone through the John Wooden UCLA program. Wilt Chamberlain doesn't seem to fit that mold, and yet John Wooden, being the lifelong learner that he is and a lifelong coach and lifelong leader that he was still getting new ideas. In fact, he talks about how you see here it was about, you know, will the Lakers coach be able to handle Wilt Chamberlain? Wilt goes, hey, you handle animals. I'm a person. You work with me. I can work with anybody who wants to work with me. And John Wooden, as you see later on, had just finished a book. And he just put it out for publication, and he had to call it back because John Wooden had a section of his book entitled How to Handle Your Players. And in that brief press conference, John Wooden had the epiphany just listening to what Wilt Chamberlain said and went, wow, I better call back all those. I didn't put that part of the quote on here, but he called back all those books, changed the title of the section to How to Work with Your Players as opposed to How to Handle Your Players. This is a sense of adaptability, whereas a young John Wooden, or even an older John Wooden as a coach, thinking about handling your players, who would be offended by that? Who would be upset by that? Along comes Wilt Chamberlain, an athlete of a new generation, an athlete of a new group, looking at the world through a different lens, and the word handle does take on a different significance, and changing that simple word from handle to work with helped to keep his message valid, to keep it vibrant, to keep it new, not new necessarily, but to keep it with the times where people understood it. And that's by adapting. It was a simple adaptation by John Wooden, but it kept his message vibrant to the modern time. What kind of applications does adaptability mean for leadership? First off, a situation which you find yourselves will constantly change. Talked about that earlier, my quote about history is constant change. What kind of things change for coaches? Societal expectations. What do they expect of us as coaches? Hey, we are products of our environment. We are products of the world we live in, the communities we live in. And what does our school expect of us? What does our parents expect of us? What do our athletes expect of us? And that will change. Now, 1989, Fontana High School won a national championship in football. That was 1989. We're in 2017. 2017, we're trying to win enough games to get back in the playoffs nowadays. As long as we're working towards that goal, people understand that. We're not under the same pressures. Now, there's other schools around that are under those pressures. If that changes, if we start to become more successful, we'll have to adapt to those pressures. That means we don't want to change what we do, but we do have to change how we do it. social norms. You know, hey, I worked for a very worked for a coach for played for a very famous coach who once told a kid, if I looked that bad on film, I'd go home and kill myself. Yeah, you wouldn't share that today. Socially norms, you just don't say that. Obviously, back then, no one really believed to go home and kill yourself. Today, we see the sadness on TV that people do this all the time. I don't know what has changed. I can't explain it, but I do know that's not something we need to share with kids nowadays. It's not some way we need to put it. We really need to be much more careful about how we speak and how we get our messages across to these kids and to the athletes and the parents we work with. Talent levels are going to change. You know, like I said, we're now a five high school town. We're not going to get layer after layer, depth after depth of athlete. We're going to get, you know, who we get. And we have to adapt to what we do there. We have to adapt to the kids we have. We have different skill levels. You know, we used to have a very strong youth program come in. Now the youth program's hit and miss. So some kids might have played for it and done very well, come in with some skills that you can work with. Sometimes you might get a class of kids come in with absolutely zero skills. They might be athletic, they might be talented, but they don't have the skills. You might have to go back and do basic skills work. Parameters of operation. What can we do? How much can we do? You know, how much can we coach those kids? How much time do we have? What do we have to fit it in? Rules of the game are going to change. You know, we find out that hitting people with your head, hey, it gives you concussions. And you know, concussions might be a bad thing. We probably need to recoach how we teach kids how to tackle because the rules have changed about how we do these things. Having to adapt to these rules, you know, we don't get to make the rules. We get maybe to influence, we get to suggest, but we don't make the rules to the sports we play in. There's other people that do that. We have to adapt what we do to fit those rules. Same thing, for instance, with coaching time limits in California, Southern California, in Southern section, I don't know about the rest of the state. Maybe they don't. I don't know. But we have an 18-hour limit that we can work with our kids every week. You know, a limit to how much we can work with our kids. What kind of jerks are you? But, you know, we have to learn how to make our time work within that 18-hour limit. And if we've got a kid who plays multiple sports, that kid can't practice more than 18 hours total. So we've got to figure out how to work those kids and work together. That's an adaptation thing. It doesn't mean we stop working with kids. It doesn't mean we give up, make them single sport kids. It means we adapt what we do to fit the new environment. And hey, I'm a baseball guy. Environmental factors. It starts raining for the first time in, you know, 2 decades in Southern California, and you have to change the way you practice. You can't practice baseball in the rain. So what do? You go and just tank it, go home, don't do anything? No. You find ways to work around it. We have auto shop, we have wood shop, we have welding. They have big empty spaces in there. Yeah, let's go play some catch indoors. You know, we could set up a soft toss screen. We could do several things. We could watch video. We could go over the mental aspects of the game. There's several things you can do to adapt the situation. But if you just tried to force it or punt because, hey, the weather changes on you. I've been a coach where we've had to cancel practices because of wildfires and smoke in the area. We've had to cancel because of excessive heat, which, man, I wish they would have done when I was a kid because I practiced in some horrendous heat. But today, if we get horrendous heat, hey, we shut down practice. Coaches got to figure out what to do because we know it's not right kid thing for the kids to do. We've adapted to the time. in order to maintain relevance as leaders, we must adapt our practice. Leaders must adapt their practices to situations in which they find themselves. Okay. I grew up in a world that was very football run oriented. Today, everybody wants to throw the ball around and spread it out. What do? Well, you do what works for the kids you have. My football coach that I hired is a very pass happy, spread the offense out kind of guy. Just so happens in the first 2 weeks of the season, we had five skill players get injured, and all the five of those skill players went both ways. So we really lost about 10 players. We were left with lots of big, strong kids and no quarterback. So what do? We start handing the ball off and running the ball a lot more, playing power football. These are the adaptations you have to make for the reality. You can't just try to force kids that can't do what you need them to do. You adapt to what you have around you. You know, it's the same thing, power versus finesse. Are we strong? Are we fast? Are we agile? What do you do as a coach? You can't always have that same kid come in. You have to be able to adapt to the kids that you get that come to you. I mean, we're a high school. We're not a college program. We're not a private school. We're a small inner city high school that, you know, hey, we're going to get who we get. And they're great. They're awesome kids. We love them, but they're not going to always be the same kids we want them to be. So we have to adapt to what we do. You know, are you a team, a program that can just impose your will on people because you've got that kind of depth, you've got that kind of power, you've got that kind of legacy behind you, moving you, and that's great. But sometimes you lose that, and I've seen that. I've seen it happen very quickly where you've lost the ability to impose your will on your opponent strictly by who you are. You know, how do you win when you can't impose your will anymore? Well, you might exploit the deficiencies of your opponent. You might, you know, try to find ways to just to emphasize that what you do well. Either way, you have to adapt. You apply lessons from your experience. You apply lessons from research. Hey, experience is one thing, but research helps too. My dad told a story about me and my brother, where my brother's 6'4", 270 pounds. He's about 7 years older than me, and if he wanted to get to the other side of the wall, his goal was to run through it. My goal, on the other hand, might have been to go over it or around it. And my dad told a story about that. He was like, you know, my big brother would go do everything full bore, full speed, and you know, damn the results. Whatever happens, he'll live with. Well, you know, he said I was the other one who would watch what my big brother would do. That wasn't the brightest thing to do, and I wouldn't make the same mistakes. You know, some people need to make mistakes from experience. Some people can learn from the mistakes of others. Either way, you still have to adapt. My brother learned to go around the wall. After going into it a few times, he's not that dumb. He would go around it. But he sometimes felt he could go back through the wall again if he wanted to. You have to tailor what you do to fit who you coach. You know, and that's age level, that's talent level, that's socioeconomic level, that's all the various things you do. You have to tailor what you do to fit the people that you coach, and that's part of being adaptable. Again, you might go from place A to place B. If you don't change, yes, you might keep the same concepts, the same ideas, but you're gonna have to change the clientele. Not your values again, but your message and how it gets out there. And you have to learn what makes it fun for the kids today. It just that's how it is. I don't know why we as coaches want to coach things to not be fun. I've seen it. I just watched it the other day. But the point of playing sports is to enjoy playing sports and to have fun and learn the lessons of playing sports. And we have to. I mean, I don't know about the whole, you know, Snap Twitter or, you know, Facegram and all the stuff that's going on out there. I don't get it. My wife gets it. I don't. But I know it's big for these kids, and I know it's something that they understand, and it's part of their world. So I'm like, I don't have to coach anymore. I'm talking to my coaches. I have to understand them. My coaches have to understand that world for their kids, understand what makes it fun. What was fun for me in 1993 when I graduated high school had nothing to do with the internet or cell phones. It had to do with how far my car can drive on how little gas I can put into it. But today, you know, these kids have a different idea of what's fun and what makes it fun. And to be a coach, you have to adapt what you do to make it fun for them. If leaders stubbornly adhere to rigid practices, they'll soon find their ability to lead becomes untenable. If you try to remain a dictator coach in a world that expects a transformational leader, you're not going to last very long. You're going to last as long as you have success. But the moment you don't have success, your people are going to turn on you because you've not developed that relationship with them. You've not adapted to the new world. They're not going to be ultimately loyal to you because that's what people did. People are going to aren't like that anymore. You have to be someone who's in their lives, who understands their lives and is helping make it better. If you desperately cling to a devalued philosophy, you know, what you do doesn't work. It's not working, and it may have worked at one point, but it's not working today. So do you keep doing it with the hopes it'll come back around? Oh, no. You're going to fail, and you're going to lose the people that you lead. They're not going to want to follow you anymore. You might lose the job. You might just continue in a very poor result. Either way, it's not what you want. You don't want to lose touch with those that you need to connect with most, and those are the players and the people that you need to develop that loyalty to buy into your message, to buy into your values. If you lose touch with them because you're stuck to some old idea and you can't adapt, you're not going to have people that are playing very hard for you. And you know, you can't keep trying to fit square pegs into round holes. Hey, here's an idea. Let's create some round holes, okay? Or some square poles instead of round holes. Hey, there you go. Sorry, it's too late to go rewind this, so we're gonna live with that one. As you see the joke over there on the right, the comic, you have two military personnel. This came off of a Navy website. But the bad cop doesn't seem to be getting through. Well, that's all I know. That can't be all you know. You've got to be successful. You've got to know more than just one way of teaching, one way of getting your message out there, one way of sharing what you need to share. You've got to adapt to people you see. And when you see they're not getting your message, you've got to continually adapt until they do. If you refuse to adapt, you're going to be presented with an ethical situation because you're going to be tempted to violate your principles, to violate rules, to violate things in order to keep this worldview that you want to be true, to force it to exist. I call it a fake reality. Hey, we're in the world of 2017 politics, and so fake medias and fake realities are all the news, are all the rage, right? Hey, the first things first, if I can't work with these kids I've got to find kids I can work with. So what do? I start bringing them in. And it's a very slippery slope between having a program that attracts kids coming to you because they like what you're doing and they like what you're coaching and what you're teaching and they like the success you're having versus making promises to kids to get them to come to you and reaching out and yanking them over across from other schools. It happens all the time. We know it happens out there. I don't abide by it in my programs. If I see it, I shut it down. But that's me. It's my ethical practices. That's my integrity that I talk about and with my coaches and my players. Integrity means a lot to me. So I'm not going to change that just to bring in one kid who does what I do. It doesn't make me a very good coach if I can't work with the kids I've got. Overlooking transgressions. Look at the situation recently at Baylor University. I don't want to throw them on our browser on the bus or anything, but you know, these kids that were doing some very unspeakable behaviors continued with the program. Why? Because you were building this program to be a national powerhouse and you didn't have the depth of talent to bench the kids that were the problem, so you left them on the field. What message did you really give? Is it your value of, you know, your Baptist university, your Baptist messages that you're supposed to be sharing coming out of Baylor University? Or are you sharing them that if you're good enough, you can do what you want to do and we'll still keep you on the field for as long as we can? It's a temptation. It's real. I felt it. But you can't buy into that because it just ruins the message you're sharing with kids. It ruins any positive that Baylor has done throughout the years with their Christian message and what they do. It's been devalued now. People question it, you know, is Baylor really all that? You know, you might harm athletes by using unethical means to gain their compliance, you know, putting undue pressures on kids, putting kids through unethical practice plans. You just don't want to do this to kids, but you might have to if you don't want to adjust. You force kids down this road. And eventually you're going to, like I said before in the last slide, you're just going to lose the people that you need to follow you. And the easiest one to get you down this road is everybody else is doing it. Fight with my football coach on a regular basis. But coach, everybody else is doing it. Right, we're not everybody else. And to be honest, not everybody else is doing it. I mean, we know this, that some people that are, and we know who they are. Some people we're suspicious of, but they also just are doing a great job. And the best thing for you to do is do a great job, and people will come to you. You know, if you build it, they will come. You build the program that people want to be a part of. You build the message. You build the ethics. You build the values. And people will come to you if you're building it the right way. If you have to go out and attract these people and buy these people in with promises, with anything else, it's not going to last long because you're always going to have to make one bigger purchase. You're going to have to make one bigger promise. It's not what you want to get into. Mr. Brown's book, or Coach Brown, sorry, people call me Mr. I'm Coach too. Coach Brown's book talks about how it's essential for athletes and coaches to have a teachable spirit. Because when you become protective of what you do too much that you don't want to learn, look, I learned from one of the greatest football coaches in the history of Southern California. run power wing T offense, won a national championship in 1989. And as the world changed, did he keep it? No. He went and changed what he did. They still ran power, and they still ran power out of lots of things, but they spread the field out. They ran it out of shotgun. They found different ways to do what they do to make it work in today's game. Because what had happened is there's plenty of his games on film, and people watch what they did on film. There's enough people that had defeated his teams that all they had to do was learn what these teams did to defeat them. If you've got no way to adapt, you've got nothing to change, you're going to lose. And so while people outside and look at what he did, just always thought he was doing the same thing. I've been inside as a player. I've been inside as a coach. And I saw how much we adapted what we did to change over time. Because it's necessary. Times change. Realities change. If we want to keep our values the same, we want to keep the ethics we're teaching kids the same, we have to adapt the way we share our message for the time so we can share the timeless message, the timeless ethic, the timeless value. And that's what we need to do. Again, I told you I was going to go back to John Wood, didn't I? Again, this is from the same book. It's Observations by John Wood, and I've cited it in the back there, but it's one of my favorites. It's a little book. It's got all these short, little brief stories by John Wood. And this inability to adapt, or as he says, failure to change is just stubbornness that comes from an unwillingness to learn and the inability to realize you're not perfect. Some coaches get such a big ego that they think they're perfect. I was a young coach. I thought I was perfect. I thought I just could do it. I had to learn. I'm not. Shockingly, I know. It was a blow to my ego. I didn't like it. But I had to learn that, you know, change is what you need to do. And he also shares there's not progress without change. You don't get better. You don't become a greater person. You don't live the dream if you're not going to change or progress. Now, again, he does warn you, not all change is progress. Some change is just change. And I'm sure people want to get into arguments about hope and change from the last administration. Hey, this is not the classroom for that. But, you know, change is not just for the sake of change. Progress, change for the sake of progress is what you need to do. Don't throw out the things that work, your values, your ethics, the right things to do. But throw out the things that aren't working, methods that aren't getting the message across, techniques that aren't working for you, game plans that are failing, practice plans that aren't working out. These are the things we need to adapt as we go on. Whoops. Sorry, you didn't see that either. I didn't have to say whoops. In conclusion, being adaptable allows leaders to come to terms with an ever-changing world. The world will always change. You can't stop it from changing. There's nothing you can do. You're not in control of it. You can control your response to the world around you. If your values are true, if your ethics are true, if you believe in what you want or what you believe is right, you adapt to the world so that you become the person that you always were in a new world. You still share the same message in a new world. Being adaptable in how the message is delivered, Corinthians, if I'm going to speak to the Jews, I need to be like a Jew, okay? You have to be adaptable to reach the greater audience. I have to change what I teach. When I speak to the students of Fontana High School, I'm going to speak differently than when I speak to the parents of the students of Fontana High School or the teachers of Fontana High School or the administrators of Fontana High School or if I speak to the district personnel at Fontana Unified School District or if I'm talking to business leaders in our community trying to get support for our kids. You have to adapt so that your message, the message you want, gets to the people that are out there. I don't adapt my message. I adapt the way I deliver the message so that everybody gets the message I'm trying to teach. And being adaptable is essential to maintaining relevance. I've seen so many coaches peak at success very early on. They had a great job and they were so convinced everything was right. They just decline from that point on or they never progress. They never get better. Adaptable, it keeps you relevant. And you have to stay relevant if you want to lead. If you want to lead from a high horse and talk about how things always were and how great things always were, great. You're going to talk about history, not the present, and certainly not the future. Not being adaptable lessens your ability to lead through crisis. You know, when things come down, when kids get hurt, when bad things happen around them, when, you know, when the world just shakes kids up, if you're not adaptable, how do you help kids lead kids through these situations? How do you, what do you teach them? That you just bang your head against the wall until you knock out? No, you teach them to find a new solution. Not being adaptable in message delivery results in the inability to find new audiences. I can't coach if I can't reach the audience I'm at. So if I come to a new place, I can't coach these new kids. I can't coach this new environment with new parents because I can't adapt the way I give my message. I can't adapt the way I share what I think is important in this world and what I think is important about sport. And not being adaptable leads the temptation to try to warp the world around you to fit the false reality you want it to be. Recruiting players, breaking the rules, violating ethics. All of these things are just the activity of an unadaptable mind who can't change the way they coach and share the message. Look, we know winning is awesome, winning is great, and losing is one of the worst things in my world. But I'd rather lose for the right reasons than win by trying to warp the world around me because I can't try to adapt my mind. I'm a little bit arrogant in that way. I think I have a pretty adaptable mind. I think I can change with the situations that I'm in and still keep the core of me the same. So to me, thinking that I would try to warp the world around me to fit my narrow worldview, that's a defeat in and of itself in my book. Okay, and in the end, being adaptable does not mean you change your values to fit the situation. Being adaptable means being able to change how your values get shared with the who, the where, and the when that you currently find yourself. That's it. You don't change your values. You don't change your ethics. You change the how that you get those messages out because you're going to always have different who's. You're going to always have different where's. You're going to always have different when's in your life. You can't change that. That is going to change. What can you change? The how. What was once taught to me that worked with kids of my generation doesn't work with kids in this generation, even at the same high school in the same town. I have to adapt. My coaches have to adapt. Heck, at this point, I'm in over a decade at our school. I have a couple coaches that are started the same time as me. They have to adapt what they do because they're now getting into a next generation of kids. And they're doing it. They're doing a great job. One of the great things I have is a very enthusiastic, adaptable staff who's willing to make the changes they need because they know the success comes from working with our kids and creating the value for our kids. Wins and losses, we've all lost. Some of us have had some successes, but we know the real secret lies in what you're teaching these kids is going to go down the path. Because really, how many of these kids are going to go on to a life in sport? I'm lucky. I wasn't the greatest athlete. I get to have a life in sport as a coach and athletic director. But, you know, most of these kids aren't. What we're teaching them is the true message. What we're trying to get out of them is the true message. And for me, one of the big things I want to teach my kids is to be adaptable to the environment to which you go into. You know, you can't always act the same way depending on where you go. You have to tailor your message to suit who you're talking to. You want the same values preached. You want the same core principles of your message to get out there. But you've got to change how you share that message. Or you're going to find it falling on deaf ears. People who don't want to listen to you. Thank you. I truly appreciate you taking the time. And I will be posting this on YouTube in a few minutes. But again, I hope you enjoyed. Thank you again, Professor Clausen. And good evening.